Friends, welcome to Somerville College and to our non-denominational chapel, as it says above the door, a house of prayer for all people. Most importantly, welcome to this very special memorial service for Shirley Williams, the Right Honourable, the Baroness Williams of Crosby. This is a celebration of the life of an extraordinary woman of whom we are inordinately proud. Shirley was the finest example of a Somervillian. Her intellect, passion, and kindness emanated from a profound commitment to the values that we hold dear. She was a giant in British politics, but so much more. She was a feminist. She was a woman of great intellect who cared deeply and worked tirelessly to bring about greater social and economic justice for all. Shirley touched the lives of people all over the world, including countless friends and colleagues, as well as Somervillians who are present today and those who are joining us from different parts of the globe. Thank you for being with us.
Let us pray. God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for Shirley Williams, for the grace and mercy she received from you, for all that was good in her life, for the memories we treasure today. Remember for good this your servant, as we also remember her. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven. Amen.
Principal Rebecca, I won't in these brief remarks list all the main achievements in the life of Shirley Williams, a life well lived by a good woman who was one of the half dozen most significant female figures in British public life in the last 75 years. It was wholly appropriate that she was, like her mother, a Somervillian. The college was, after all, and the principal alluded to this, founded with a particular emphasis on liberal values and on the promotion of equality, not least in terms of gender in education and across the whole of our society. Shirley's life touched all these compass points with the addition of international cooperation, which again has been reflected in the college's close connections with India. I want to make 5 points briefly. First, we are often understandably inclined to associate virtues which most of us think we should admire with democracy. For example, we would prefer to think of reasonableness rather than ruthlessness when considering success in democratic politics. Well, Shirley Williams was reasonable to a fault, some used to argue, though not this speaker. To help people towards a consensus, as she did, in trying to find ways of coping with the predicaments of life, seems to me a great talent and a great virtue. If she had been ruthless, Shirley Williams might well have got to the very top of the political greasy pole. I concede that it's always possible to appear to be reasonable while getting others to be ruthless on your behalf. I can think of at least one prominent example of a politician who behaved like this in recent years. Shirley Williams would have found that hypocritical, and it would have involved her in a degree of casuistry entirely foreign to her character. This reasonableness affected her life as a profoundly believing Catholic, a faith she took from her father, intent on finding ways of bridging the gap between her church and the contemporary world. Like Pope Francis, she would not have agreed with Cardinal Manning's admiration for what he called the beauty of inflexibility. I agree with most of her principal criticisms of the church in which she worshipped for most of her life, as do so many Catholics like me in the privacy of their thoughts and daily lives, though sometimes publicly too. Second, Shirley Williams believed in equality and would have been pleased when Pope Paul VI's great encyclical, Populorum Progressio, sought to place the Catholic Church unequivocally on the side of the poor in the world, including, of course, in Britain. As we approach Christmas this year, I'm sure she would have been shocked, as I am, by the growing necessity of food banks in our own fairly prosperous country. Third, Shirley Williams worked as a politician to promote equality and social mobility through education. Some would argue that she put too much emphasis on removing the 11 plus and ending the life of so many grammar schools. The truth is that separation of children into two streams at the age of 11 no longer seemed fair to most parents. The 11 plus exam was supposed to assign your child to the sort of education which was most suitable for her or him. But how credible was that to parents whose children were sent to schools which were invariably less well funded and endowed with less esteem? We might also remember that more grammar schools were probably closed by Margaret Thatcher, Somerville, and Edward Boyle than by Shirley Williams. The real problem that she and others, I think, underestimated was caused by the fact that the closure of grammar schools coincided, perhaps accidentally, with what seemed to be a decline in the emphasis on rigor in education. Moreover, we have still not resolved satisfactorily the question of how to ensure that clever children from disadvantaged backgrounds and areas have the opportunity to reap the benefits of a not yet wholly open meritocracy. Fourth, I imagine that Shirley would have been appalled by the growth of identity politics and nationalism in the 21st century. She continually spoke out in favor of international cooperation in economic, political, cultural, and personal terms, and in security as well, where she was a constant campaigner for non-proliferation. Here she was influenced, perhaps, by her father's work on just war theory. She would, of course, have favored the concept of global Britain, but would have known that its implementation would be jeopardized, indeed buried, by Westphalian and 19th century notions of sovereignty. And the final point I want to make, I was greatly moved by the deaths of three men whom I knew and much admired: Nelson Mandela, Kofi Annan, and most recently Colin Powell. I noted in each case the misuse of the term charisma in describing them. You look up the word on the internet and you find lists of those allegedly charismatic, covering, in one example, I kid not, people ranging from Hitler to Bono and Rihanna. But what did the Greeks and what did St. Paul mean by the term? Literally, they were talking of authority touched by grace. There are not many public figures in my experience whom you can really call charismatic in that correct sense. Shirley Williams was surely one of them. Now, to be charismatic, you're not required to arrive on time for your meetings. Like President Clinton, Shirley Williams was a serial challenger to Greenwich Mean Time. Nor do you have to be bandbox, to use a phrase much liked by my mother. It would not be unfair to say that Shirley usually looked a tad ruffled. But what she then said in that slightly throaty voice, having probably arrived late at her meeting, was not at all ruffled. It was lucidly composed and came not from a script, but from a warm heart and a crystal clear head. She possessed intellectual authority and a personality touched by grace. She was a politician whose career was infused by a sense of moral values, and whose life should inspire young women and young men to become public servants and to regard politics not as just another way of making a living, an occasionally rather mean-spirited, if flashy, path to be taken by selfish careerists. Her life showed, not least to the public who knew, admired, and often loved her, that politics really can and should be an honorable adventure. Somerville should be and is rightly proud of its distinguished daughter. She is precisely what this college is so admirably about. And the university as a whole is proud of her, as it is of the achievements and character of this college. Shirley Williams, now on Canaan's side, requiescat in parce, Somerville College, ad multos annos.
Shirley's extraordinary life has been well documented, and we've just heard a very moving and insightful perspective on her public career. We will hear shortly from friends and family who have lost a most exceptional and dearly loved and loving friend, mother, and grandmother, and I feel deeply for the gap she's left in their lives. Somerville alumni, too, have personal memories, and for me, it was a fantastic privilege and also a joy during and after my years as principal to get to know Shirley and become her friend. I will focus here mainly on Shirley as the person the Somerville community has lost. She served the college as an honorary fellow from the time when she first entered Harold Wilson's government, and I mean she really did serve. The college was her place, not invariably approved of, but a place where she felt at home. Shirley came to speak in Somerville readily and often. She came to stay more than once with my husband and me in Radcliffe House and participated in at least one of the special gatherings of honorary fellows that met to discuss the college's policies. She cared especially about an inclusive admissions policy, was glad that we were doing a bit better than most colleges in admitting students from state schools, and made sure we knew that she was watching every step. And she would be delighted with the strides that have been made in the past few years in this respect. Each time she came, there would come with her, or soon afterwards, a gift of documents and memorabilia from her own and her mother's lives, letters from and to Vera Brittain, one or two commemorative trophies of her own, and then recovered, I'm told, from under a bed, a portrait of Edward Brittain, the uncle she never met. I recall very happily the times when I would shepherd her through the college to an event, allowing plenty of time for being stopped by people who wanted to talk to her, when she would herself stop completely and stand chatting with them as though she had all the time in the world. And also on more than one occasion, pausing to identify the precise spot on the little Clarendon Street wall that she had favored as an undergraduate for climbing into college after hours. Climbing in, remembered fondly by generations of Somervillians, was an occupational hazard of Shirley's extremely active undergraduate social life. But alongside her glamorous social life, the undergraduate Shirley Catlin had a deep concern about the social deprivation that prevailed in post-war Britain. Having worked before Oxford as a farm worker cowhand and as a waitress in a hotel in Whitley Bay, she understood class differences at first hand. Her memoirs also comment on the underlying seriousness of the generation of rather older than average undergraduates who had fought in the Second World War, some of them coming from impoverished backgrounds that would have been more uncommon in Oxford before the war. As far as Shirley's oft-neglected studies at Oxford were concerned, she enjoyed economics more than philosophy in her PPE course, and writes revealingly in her memoirs, "I was fortunate in having a wonderful tutor, a woman for whom the word gaiety might have been invented. Margaret Hall was elegant, brilliant, vibrant, and occasionally frivolous. She wore scarlet suits and very high heels and had a mind like a razor, precise, sharp, and effective. She exemplified what I wanted to be, an outstanding professional, an attractive woman, and a wife and mother. She understood that for me, economics was not an interest, but a tool." There is so much of Shirley herself in that description, though possibly not including the very high heels. In another book, God and Caesar, Shirley wrote of her Roman Catholic faith, to which she converted formally in her first year at Oxford, which underpinned some controversial political choices. While studying PPE was almost incidental to all the other excitements of life at Oxford, the questions it posed, the discussions with friends and other groups that it informed, and the interaction between her studies and her faith together made up the background to the public career of this great woman of conscience. Shirley Williams's formal career started as a journalist with the Daily Mirror and then the Financial Times. She fought her first parliamentary election as Labour candidate for Harwich in a 1954 by-election and the subsequent general election, stood for Southampton in 1959, became General Secretary of the Fabian Society in 1960, and was elected MP for Hitchin in 1964. Always a passionate internationalist, she repudiated the Labour Party's initial opposition to British entry into the EEC, but nevertheless held ministerial appointments in Harold Wilson's government. And in 1976, James Callaghan promoted her to Secretary of State for Education. In later life, she would tell a Somerville gathering that the achievement in office she felt most proud of was the creation of comprehensive schools. Ironically, as the Chancellor has alluded to, she and her Somervillian near-contemporary Margaret Thatcher both served as Secretaries of State for Education, and both pushed forward the replacement of grammar schools by comprehensives, though from very different political stances. But it was Shirley who abolished the 11 plus. Of course, she would not have wished to be mentioned too often in the same sentence as her fellow Somervillian, even though she could be generous about her. In her memoirs, she recounts how she caught sight of Margaret Thatcher watching intently from behind the speaker's chair when she, Shirley, gave her first speech as Secretary of State for Prices and Consumer Protection, heavily heckled in what was then an overwhelmingly male house. She retreated after that ordeal to the lady members' room, where she found Mrs. Thatcher ironing a dress. Apparently she did a lot of ironing. Mrs. Thatcher looked up from her ironing and said, "You did well. After all, you can't let them get the better of us." The years after the Callaghan government lost the general election of 1979 and the fissure in the Labour Party that led to Shirley's leading role in forming the SDP and eventually to the formation of the Liberal Democratic Party are subjects for others to speak about. Shirley Williams became, after leaving the Commons at the general election of 1983, both a member of the House of Lords and a professor at the Kennedy School of Government in Harvard. She married her second husband, the Harvard political scientist Richard Neustadt, in 1987, a relationship that brought her deep happiness. She remained very much engaged in British and European political life, serving for some years as leader of the Lib Dems in the House of Lords, and worked on producing new constitutions for several East European countries. She campaigned with all her heart against Brexit, and I remember marching to hear Shirley speak at a million-strong demonstration in Parliament Square. She was awarded an honorary degree at Oxford, among other universities, and appointed a Companion of Honour in the New Year's Honours of 2017. And she remained sought after as a public speaker and broadcaster in that beautiful, distinctive voice that we can all remember with such pleasure, nearly to the end of her life. When I was a Somerville undergraduate in the late 1960s, my friends and I all hoped and expected that the first woman to become Prime Minister of this country would be Shirley Williams. We hero worshipped her from a distance and saw in her the embodiment of some of the college's most cherished progressive values. When asked at a college meeting decades later whether she would ever consider rejoining the Labour Party, she said, "No, Labour was not sound on civil liberties." There lay behind that polite but firm reply a profound fidelity to the rights and liberties she considered most important. She also cared about Somerville's role in educating women. Feminism was part of her public identity, perhaps not to the same extent as it had been in her mother's life, because Shirley was famous for so much more, but fundamentally important nonetheless. And for her, the college was an important bastion of women's rights. When, in the early 1990s, Somerville's governing body finally yielded to the inevitable and decided to admit men, Shirley gave strong support to the alumni and students who resisted this decision. Fortunately, she didn't hold it against us for the rest of her life. Somerville had been founded in 1879 as one of the first two Oxford colleges for women and the one that opened its doors to undergraduates from all parts of society and all religious persuasions. Its raison d'etre was to include the excluded, as we like to point out today. For Shirley, it was still important to provide some form of social and intellectual shelter for women in what she knew from her own experience was still, to some extent, a man's world. And from a modern perspective, she asked me once whether I didn't feel that Muslim women in particular would feel exposed and even threatened in a college that included men. Her own experience of Oxford had not exactly excluded men, but she was solicitous for those from other cultures to whom modesty and some degree of seclusion mattered. Her magnetic empathy with people, and especially women of other generations and other cultures, was very much of a piece also with her deep interest in India, which the Chancellor has mentioned. She visited the Rajasthan community of Sevamandir several times and became a patron of its friends, inspired by the grassroots democracy that she saw represented in this great rural NGO. It would give her great pleasure to know that Somerville is considering possibly a more formal relationship with them. And she rejoiced when the college established its Oxford India Centre for Sustainable Development with its Indira Gandhi scholarships. She was also very proud of her mother's feminist record, and in the centenary years of the First World War, she dedicated much time to celebrating Vera Brittain's contribution. As she reminded us, her mother was the best-known woman writer of that epoch. And in 2013, the college opened its new Brittain Williams Room. Shirley came to open it and to speak about her mother. We followed that occasion with a dinner, and I invited several students. Shirley had been going all day, speaking formally, chatting informally to any number of admirers at the reception that preceded dinner. Then, just as dinner was coming to a close and I was thinking of getting her back to the house for a well-earned night's sleep, the students clustered around her to ask for advice about setting up a role in the JCR for a women's officer and a host of other issues. They literally sat at her feet and chanced to be able to talk to her about the things that mattered to them, and they wouldn't let her go. That moment stays in my mind as a touching evidence of Shirley's extraordinary ability to appeal to people across the generations. I can think of few others, if any, whose reputation would have been as fresh and iconic to today's students as it was to all the generations going back to her own undergraduate days. Above all, Shirley's affection for Somerville was completely unsentimental and transcended sectionalism of any kind. It was embodied in her words quoted on the college website. "For me," she wrote, "the lessons of a childhood shared with a great Somervillian and of a life lived and shaped by Somerville are these: think, write, and read always, live and work vividly, and bring your mind to bear on everything from the tiniest practical problem to the widest social issue. Respect the views of others and of the past, but don't let that stop you being awkward when you need to be. Argue for what you believe and do it well."
Thank you. Shirley arrived in Somerville in October 1948 like a thunderbolt. She marched straight into the principal's office and announced, "You can keep your bloody scholarship, I don't want it." Dame Janet Vaughan, distinguished scientist and principal of Somerville, rose to her feet, crossed the room, and folded herself down on the floor, patting the space beside her. "Come and sit down," she said, "and tell me what you're so cross about." It emerged that Shirley thought she had been offered the scholarship in honor, or even worse, at the behest of her mother, Vera Brittain, famous author of Testament of Youth, and herself a graduate of Somerville, and she, Shirley, was having none of it. Once this had been cleared up, she and Dame Janet became good friends. Shirley became instantly a familiar figure in Oxford. In her long scommers gown, her rolling gait like a sailor newly arrived on land, blonde hair all over her face like a Shetland pony, gravelly speaking voice and angelic singing voice, she was everywhere, at every meeting of the Labour Club, and in due course its chair, in the gallery of the Union. Women were of course not allowed on the floor or to take part in debate. We were only allowed to listen. And a member of the Ouds, the Dramatic Society, where she played Desdemona to Peter Parker's Othello, and they toured the United States with the production in the second summer vacation. One term she was portrayed as the Isis idol in the University magazine, I don't know if it still exists. Very exceptional for a woman. And of course, she was invited to every desirable party and commem ball. Somerville was still, and for many years to come, a female bastion, and one of the only five women's colleges in Oxford. There were no co-educational ones. Men were allowed on the premises only between the hours of 2 and 6 p.m. At least we did not, as our predecessors had, to have to roll our beds out of our rooms into the corridor if a man came to call. When the gates opened at 2, the corridors rang with the sound of male footsteps, and Shirley's room was always besieged. Though the war had ended in 1945, there had still been conscription, and many of the male undergraduates had had some experience of the services, which made them much more interesting than boys straight from school. There was an 11 p.m. curfew, so Shirley had a special climbing in place, which she pointed out very nostalgically only a couple of years ago to me. With all this activity, it was hard to find time for the weekly essays. And at least once a week, Shirley would arrive at breakfast, pink-eyed, and more than usually disheveled, having worked all night. I should explain, I don't know if I should explain, that food was still rationed during most of our time at Oxford. And so we surrendered our ration books to the college and had most of our meals, including breakfast, communally in hall. At one point in the second year, Shirley was even deprived of her scholarship for a while. She hated having to wear the skimpy commoner's gown, but it was soon reinstated. In the third year, work had to be taken seriously, and as she found the philosophy part of her PPE degree the most difficult, she turned to a Balliol undergraduate, Bernard Williams, known for his brilliance in the subject, for some private tuition, and they too became friends. And so in 1951, Shirley left Oxford, not with a first-class degree that she might well have achieved if only there had been more hours in the day, but with a good second and a host of friends, most of them for life. Thank you.
Perhaps inevitably at this stage in proceedings, much of what I'm going to say has been said by others before me, but I'm somewhat comforted by the thought that Shirley was the same to everyone that she met, to her family and her friends, and she was wholly genuine. So I make no apology for making some of the same points again. My mother was a proud Somervillian. She was associated with Somerville throughout her life. She was the daughter of a feminist who had fought hard for the right to study at Oxford, as an undergraduate establishing the roots of her political career, and later as a mentor for young women for whom she perfectly epitomised the characteristics of the Somervillian, inquiring, confident, and independently minded. Yet despite her strong identification with the college, she did have an ambivalence about what Oxford represented. Among Shirley's most admirable qualities were her modesty, her genuine interest in people, whatever their background and position in life, and above all, kindness. She hated pretension and artifice. How she appeared in public, humble, warm, and approachable, was exactly who she was. She loved Oxford for the wonderful experiences she had here as an undergraduate, and for the close friends she made here. But she did not want to be part of what she saw as the public association of Oxford with privilege. It was for this reason, I believe, that whenever asked, she always declined to have her name put forward, whether for Chancellor of the University or as head of a college. In fact, as Helga has mentioned, she nearly did not come to Somerville at all. My mother was a woman of principle, as her mother had been before her. That prompted her to reject the scholarship that Somerville offered, following what she understood to be the suggestion that a place could be found for the daughter of a Somerville graduate. However, Shirley, as she was fond of recalling, did meet her match in the interview with the formidable Janet Vaughan, then principal. I believe she was swiftly disabused of the notion that patronage or nepotism would hold any sway over her admission, and that meeting formed the basis of a lifelong admiration of Dame Janet and association with the college. She came to know subsequent Somerville principals, some of whom became close friends and who are here today. My mother had an exciting and unconventional childhood before she came to Oxford. Her own mother was unusual at the time for herself being an Oxford graduate, a writer, and a feminist. Shirley had been introduced as a child to the many and varied visitors from across the globe who flowed through her parents' London home. And she spent some years of the war as a child, thousands of miles away from her family in America. That experience of independence at a young age and in a new world was profoundly formative, I believe. So what could Oxford and Somerville offer her after that start in life? My mother was never one to waste an opportunity. She threw herself into life with extraordinary levels of energy and enthusiasm. Oxford, as others have mentioned, just after the war, offered excitement and hope for a new world. She described in her memoirs climbing the bookshelves the presence of ex-servicemen in the university then, many of whom were the first in their family to have the opportunity of a university education. She recognised that their war experience brought a unique quality to the undergraduates of the era. Oxford gave Shirley the foundations of her political life through the Oxford Labour Club, the experience of facing a public audience through performing with Ouds, and as Helga has mentioned, a surprising, at least to her, appearance as Isis Idol in the well-known student publication. As the Chancellor mentioned, it was in Oxford that she made the commitment to her Catholic faith, as her father had done before her as an Oxford undergraduate, a faith that was a hugely important part of her life. Her studies in PPE, while sometimes neglected in pursuit of more immediately exciting opportunities, as she freely admitted, provided her with the tools of her future career. At Somerville were forged the closest female friendships of her life, as well as the confirmation of her early instinctive understanding that women were the intellectual equals to men. I suspect that Oxford and Somerville in particular formed a much bigger influence in my mother's life than she had initially expected. She understood that for her mother it had been a point of principle to gain place at Oxford, to prove she was the intellectual equal of her brother, whose attendance at New College was expected until the First World War disrupted the hopes and expectations of a generation. For Shirley, politics was her lifeblood even before Oxford. She anticipated that university would be a necessary brief interruption to her future political life. In fact, it turned out to be the crucible of that life. It was here that she made significant friendships and crystallized a framework of philosophical and political values that underpinned the changing social and political landscape of her long life and varied experiences post-Oxford. Those experiences straddled the worlds of elected politics and academia in Britain, America, and further afield, including a lifelong love of India. She advised former Soviet states seeking to build democratic structures for the first time. She worked against worldwide nuclear proliferation and sought to promote fairness and equality of opportunity wherever she found it lacking. In all of this, she had a great ability to connect with the people that she met, regardless of background, politics, or culture. Her intrinsic qualities of an inquiring mind, an essential integrity, and a profound curiosity about people and places were and are the hallmark of a true Somervillian. Thank you.
I'd like to start by thanking you all for being here today. Somervillians, friends, family, thank you for gathering here today to honour in Shirley's memory. Shirley was a unique melting pot of a vast array of truly wonderful qualities. From her diligence in her political duty to her deep-wired fundamental compassion. Anybody here will willingly attest to that. And it's quite remarkable that for a transformative figure in partisan political terms, Shirley has retained such a glowing legacy across the political spectrum, among commentators, and in her infectious effect on the general public. When I was growing up, the way in which I perceived my grandmother's status was the result of a career in politics, academia, and activism spanning several decades. The seasoned, wise political matriarch was indeed the only version of Shirley that I did know. I did not know Shirley, the Shirley that had fled home for America as an evacuee. The Shirley who forced her way into a sexist political scene of the 1960s. The academic in the United States, or indeed the Shirley that came here to Somerville. Shirley was someone with a life full of formative influences, and crucially, somebody who often saw little utility in dwelling on or replaying the past. Despite this, it was far from difficult to ascertain the lifelong affinity that Shirley felt to this place, or indeed the way in which it shaped her character for the rest of her career and her life. As my mother has already demonstrated eloquently, Shirley was deeply perturbed by the sense of any sense of privilege or of snobbery. I need not name names when I say there are certain individuals right at the heart of our contemporary politics for whom their education has failed to remove their privilege. For Shirley, her education did not in any way harm her sense of humility, service, and belief in the need for basic human connection with people of any and all backgrounds. Indeed, Shirley fought fiercely for much of her career for the elimination of obvious barriers to the provision of true equality in education in this country. I have a crystal clear memory of Shirley being recognized when her car had broken down some 10 or 15 years ago. "You look remarkably similar to Shirley Williams," said the gentleman enthusiastically, perhaps fishing for a story about running into a frontline politician. Shirley's response, "I must look very similar to her then." She felt no need to extract the self-indulgence of being recognized in public. But countless other times this happened whilst I was with her, this humility remained the same. She was far more interested in learning about the other person in an almost anthropological way. Whether it was the influence of her religion or other factors, she had a legitimate belief in the value of humankind. Rarely did Shirley allow emotion to play a role in how she carried herself, but in my life, one of the rare occasions in which I saw her genuinely grief-stricken was her reaction to the migrant crisis in Europe in the mid to late 2010s. Shirley never felt the need to boast or even comment on her status, her great mind, or her education, among other qualities. For her, these things were tools with which to achieve lasting change for people across the country. To her, politics was not about power, climbing the ladder slowly in pursuit of a leadership role. It was about using the tools that she was blessed with in a manner of stewardship and humble representation, devoid of even a smidge of pretension. In this way, Shirley represents the very best that an education at Somerville and at Oxford can produce. She used her time here to sharpen her intellect, establish herself as a key figure in the Labour movement, and prove herself a formidable force to be reckoned with. For her, the developmental opportunities offered by an education at a world-class university were far more important than simply the act of going to one. Her years here were the beginning of her quest to forge real change in society, and she began with serving as the first female chair of the Oxford Labour Club, a hugely significant milestone in the female political leadership, even if the parliamentary party hasn't quite got the memo yet. It is easy in a day where such progress has been made in establishing truly authoritative female voices in politics and in wider society for us to misremember the circumstances of Shirley's time. Shirley and her mother's lives were often regarded by many as out of place, being influential female figures, using the inspiration of their Somerville education to fight causes dear to their hearts. Shirley and her mother are both steadfast testimonials to Somerville's ability to shape future leaders and change makers. Shirley was always immensely proud of the fact that her and her mother's achievements were also, in a way, Somerville's achievements. I owe a huge debt of gratitude to the college for their work in commemorating my grandmother and my great-grandmother's achievements. Among other things, the establishment of the Britton Williams Room and academic initiatives in Shirley's name. So I would like to leave you with one final thought to reflect on. My grandmother and I shared an incredibly close bond, and at times an almost telepathic understanding. Among all of her successes and characteristics that I came to understand so deeply and be so aware of, it was her humble sense of dedication and duty, a first among equals approach, that I was most proud of. When I mentioned earlier the uncertainty of the gentleman as to whether he had indeed met Shirley, it was because she had a remarkable ability to blend in. Her appearance and the way she carried herself meant that she could not be picked out of a line at a bus stop. And she was anything but what stereotypes would have us believe that most politicians are supposed to be or how they act. Her wonderfully sharp mind and her commitment to changing the world around her, from European integration to nuclear policy, are products of her education right here at this place. May we all take Shirley's example forward in life, talented and fortunate in her upbringing and her opportunities, but unreservedly humble and fundamentally human in every encounter that she went about. Thank you very much.
I first met Shirley in 1972 in my first year at Oxford when she came to speak to the Labour Club, of which I was then a member. I got to see her in action in subsequent years when I was the young European left representative on the Labour Committee for Europe. And I got to know her well when I joined the staff of the SDP in spring 1981, and particularly from 1982 to 1988, when I was the party's chief executive and she was the party's president, and we worked together on a daily basis. On joining the Lords in 1997, I then served under her during her time as leader. And when I became leader myself, I was nominally and extremely improbably her leader. I was therefore able to see, work with, and appreciate Shirley for almost 50 years. She was throughout a personal supporter and became a good friend. You've already heard something of a political career, but I make no apology for repeating some of it. As the daughter of Labour elite, she was General Secretary of the Fabian Society before she became an MP at the remarkably young age for a woman of 33. She rapidly climbed the greasy pole in a series of posts during those Wilson governments of the 1960s, most notably serving as Minister of State at the Department of Education, where, as Lord Patton has said, her advocacy of comprehensive schools first brought her to national attention. After Labour's defeat in 1970, she was member of the Shadow Cabinet. And after rebelling over British membership of the EU, she was demoted by Wilson from Shadow Home Secretary to Prices and Consumer Protection. She occupied that position in Cabinet in the post-1974 Labour government before becoming Secretary of State for Education in 1976. She lost her Stevenage seat in the 1979 election, and as a staunch European and opponent of the left, she was increasingly disillusioned with Michael Foot as leader of the Labour Party. Despite her strong political and emotional ties to Labour, she was instrumental in the formation of the SDP as one of the Gang of Four, with Roy Jenkins, David Owen, and Bill Rogers. Months after the party's formation, she passed up the chance to fight the party's first by-election in Warrington, which Roy Jenkins fought and narrowly lost, and she would probably have won. It was her biggest political mistake, and although impossible to foresee at the time, made the possibility of a real alliance breakthrough in 1983 at the subsequent general election much more difficult and, in practice, impossible. Although she won a subsequent by-election in Crosby, she lost her seat in 1983 and with it any chance of leading the SDP. Instead, she became the party's president for the remainder of the party's independent life and had to play second fiddle to David Owen. Not always an easy role. She was a pragmatist on the SDP's relations with the Liberal Party, and by 1987 had come to accept the inevitability of a merger of the parties. And although the merger did occur, it came at a great political cost, and the new Lib Dems had to rebuild from scratch. Shirley sensibly decided to do something else and began her academic career at Harvard. But she returned to Parliament, having been made a peer in 1993, and became leader of the Lib Dems in the Lords 8 years later. She spoke with her usual passion and persuasion in the Lord, but she regarded the Lord as an outdated, idiosyncratic institution, as indeed it is, and was much happier doing media performances, for which she remained throughout her life in very high demand. She formally retired from the Lords in 1916 at the age of 85, and she went out in style with a lavish party in the Common Speaker's House, complete with concert pianist and laudatory speeches. But she immediately regretted it. Having had the party, however, the die was cast. This didn't deter her from being a regular visitor to the Lords, which usually involved an unannounced visit to my office, where she would invariably have a minimum of three ideas, which, if immediately implemented, would transform the party's fortunes and or win the Brexit referendum and or then derail the government's Brexit plans. More than anyone else, however, that I can think of, a recitation of Shirley's tangible achievements as a politician doesn't begin to tell the whole story of her contribution to British political life. She had an infectious enthusiasm for political ideas and activity. She believed that politics was an honourable calling and passionately encouraged people, particularly young people and women, to take up a political vocation. She was a brilliant listener, head cocked, encouraging smile, and was willing to spend time discussing politics with anyone, anywhere, anytime. Speaking from a public platform, she brought conviction, sincerity, and enthusiasm. On radio and TV, she demonstrated the same qualities, making her a very frequent performer on flagship programs such as Question Time and Any Question. As we've already heard, she connected with people to a remarkable extent. People who met her by chance on the street or on a train felt that they could speak to her almost as if she was an old friend. Other politicians with whom I've worked, particularly Charles Kennedy and Paddy Ashdown, had some of this instant recognition and rapport, but none of them could match Shirley. In the Alliance years, she became known as Shirl the Pearl, a sobriquet which reflected this attraction and the affection which it invoked. What was her secret? Part of it was that she liked to be liked and subconsciously tried hard to make people like her. Partly, it was a genuine interest in people and their views. And partly, again, as Lord Patton has said, it was a natural charisma, which, like that of other charismatic leaders, Obama, Clinton, Mandela, was simply innate. Two anecdotes sum up her appeal to me. In the Warrington by-election, she took part in a motorcade, complete with a handheld loudspeaker, standing on the passenger seat of a car, with her head poking through the sunroof. As we went down a road in a council estate, a man who was underneath his car, repairing it, hearing the din, poked his head out to see what the fuss was all about. Looking up from a prone position, he saw Shirley. He beamed. "Hello, Shirley," he said, as if greeting an old friend. What other politician could generate such positive response from a total stranger? And secondly, at the end of my first year working for the SDP, on our way up to see my parents in Yorkshire for Christmas, we stayed over with Shirley at Furnow Pelham. We had dinner with other political friends. We went to bed extremely late. Shirley, as we've heard, had a student's insatiable enthusiasm for discussing political ideas. The next morning, a gentle rap on our bedroom door announced Shirley bringing myself and my wife a cup of tea. How could anybody not be entranced? The downside of wanting to be popular, however, meant that she took on far too many engagements than the calendar allowed. She gained a reputation deservedly for often being late as she tried to bend time to her calendar with predictable results. SDP staff developed the concept of Shirley time and would often schedule meetings in her diary for 15 or 30 minutes earlier than the real start time, simply to ensure that she arrived punctually. But there was a further reason for this apparent disorganisation. Shirley, during the peak of her career, was a single mother, juggling running a household, bringing up Becky, and organising her own life with completely inadequate support. Until she married Dick Neustadt, she had to carry the burden of personal and political decision-making almost entirely on her own shoulders. And unlike other members of the Gang of Four, for example, and following the death of her trusted and shrewd aide, John Little, in the early life of the SDP, she lacked a senior day-to-day political advisor, lacked first-class administrative backup, and most crucially, lacked day-to-day emotional support. If she'd been a man, these issues may not well have mattered as much. We can all think, without too much difficulty, of disorganized male politicians. But it was used as a stick to beat Shirley, which both rankled her and unfairly diminished her standing. Shirley, like all of us, was a product of her time. But her standout qualities of empathy, enthusiasm, and the belief that political activity in support of a fair and tolerant society is a noble cause, a timeless. How we miss her voice today.
And the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, in his mercy, may he give us a safe lodging, and a holy rest, and peace at the last. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon us and remain with us always. Amen.